The next stage is to go through the dozen or so photographs that I've got and the two videos that I was sent to find out through a bit of investigative forensic work, to find out what have I bought.
I'm Andrew St. Pierre White. Join me as I share my passion for building four-wheel drive trucks and traveling to the remotest parts of the world.
Yes, I bought the Range Rover blind, but why wouldn't you? These vehicles are so rare. On car sales, where I found the vehicle, there were three two-door classics available, and this one, while not fully restored, was so original, I couldn't pass it up. And I found in my boxes of Range Rover memorabilia this brochure. This is the 1976 Range Rover brochure, and as you can see, it features the Sahara Dust Range Rover. The Range Rover was made in a number of colors. Sahara Dust is probably one of the least common, together with Maasai Red, then probably becoming more popular, Tascan Blue, and then Lincoln Green, and probably the most popular two colors, Bahama Gold and Davis White. And my first Range Rover was a Davis White one, as was my father's. And as you can see, there is a color missing. And the missing color is Sahara Dust. That's because he took it out, went to the dealer and gave it to the dealer and said, that's what I want. And they weren't available. They were in such short supply. The waiting time was, I seem to remember, 5 months. And we took what we could get, which turned out to be a white one. This brochure, of course, shows the Range Rover in its natural habitat. Later Range Rover brochures, as years went on, the Range Rover was seen fewer and fewer times in the environment for which it was built. And this is marvelous. Look at this. Absolutely, absolutely fantastic. Even there in a gliding, flying environment. And as you can imagine, as a young lad with this, I had this long before I got my own Range Rover. All of these pictures were really, really exciting. And it's a well-worn brochure because, well, I wore it out. And the beautiful interior, and of course, the guy gets the girl. And there is the absolutely stunning interior. Now, the main differences between the vehicle that I owned and this really are cosmetic. They changed the location of the wing mirrors, they put some carpet on the transmission tunnel, and they improved the seats by giving them a different, a less slippery cloth covering. Look at this guy. He can't even drive in a straight line. Now what I have to do now is go through my book that I created. This is a record of my own Range Rover and its progress from when I purchased it to when I sold it. And I'll read the very first entrance for you. Dad drove me to Vereeniging to view a 1971 Davis Mark I Range Rover owned by a Mr. Kiffert. Being a Mark I version, was completely bare inside, but was in superb condition all round, and she seemed to go very well. Four extra tyres were part of the deal, and the asking price, 8,000 Rand, and I made an immediate offer of 7,000, which was turned down. I actually managed to scrape together another 500, counter-offered 7,500, and eventually paid 7,800 for the car. The first figure I wrote down, giving the Odo reading, was 4,500 miles, which is very close to the 74,000 kilometers indicated on the new Range Rover. And this is a very detailed record of what I did. Let's take an arbitrary one to, you see there, engine removal. Let's have a look at this. Engine dismantling, 3rd of the 8th of August 1986, 5 hours. Engine cleaned, removed, clutch, still in fairly good condition. Taffet covers, valve gear, head, flywheel. And on the 16th of September 1986, after playing with the ignition timing, the motor started, ran smoothly, 1,000 to 1,500 RPM. And if I go right to the end of this story, and it's still even today, fills, I get a lump in my throat if I remembered the fantastic time I had with my Range Rover at 118,149 miles. This is the last entry. Lodi is gone. That's 11:05 a.m. Now, I don't name a lot of my cars, but this one was called Lodi, from Lodi in the United States, actually from the Creedence Clearwater Revival song, Lodi. And the last entry is the thing that brings a lump to my throat every time I read it. Lodi was bought on the 15th of May 1982. I have owned her for 8 years, 8 months and 8 days. I have covered over 76,149 miles. That's 121,838 kilometers. I bought her for 7,500 rands and sold her for 26,000 rands. That's an average of 17.5 liters per 100 kilometers. And she would have consumed 21,321.65 litres of fuel. The end. Right, Lodi part two. What have I bought? Now, if I look at the photographs, maybe I should go to my computer, look at the photographs, look at the two videos that I have been sent, and do some diagnostic photographs first, the build plate, and that rust is surface rust and doesn't worry me at all. Confirming the engine, now that's the, not the engine number, yes that is the engine number. It's the engine number and the Australian design rule plate, which is very important. The original paperwork, Rover's manual is very nice. I have the one from mine as well. So having that is really rather handy and nice to have the original paperwork. Excited about that. Let's skip down to the actual vehicle itself. If I look closely at the bodywork, that mirror, I'm not sure if that is an original Land Rover mirror. I'm unclear about that, but it doesn't have mirrors on the bonnet. Now, in 1976, they moved the mirrors from the bonnet to here. So I'm not sure. This was actually built in 1975 and first registered in January 1976. So I'm unclear of that, whether that has been a modification during the vehicle's life. I really cannot tell at this time. Only mirror on the one side. The front bumper has been restored. And the lights look very good. I think they might be new. Wheels definitely restored, which is great. Again, the rust here is surface rust. Doesn't worry me too much. Where the rust can be a problem with these Range Rovers is tailgate. I don't have too many photographs of that, but I'm told that there's no rust, which is very, very important. But I see here, and this is significant, That is the original radiator. That is the original expansion tank. A battery on only one side, which is good. Wiring a bit untidy, which is not a bad sign, because it was untidy when it was built. So the front seats, the driver's seats has obviously been restored, but not with the same fabric material. So here's a question, is that it's very possible that the specifications for the UK vehicle and those sold in Australia were different. I need to find out whether this was actually built in Australia or imported from the UK. I think it was imported from the UK, as far as I can tell, but I'm unsure about that. The seats are a different spec. They're not the suffix A or B spec. They're a later spec of seat, but they are in nice condition, but I can see the passenger seat has not been restored in any way, so that would be the original seat. Here it's quite plain to see the carpentry. The early ones had no carpets at all, they just had a plain plastic floor. Back seat, same story. Original, as the carpet over the wheel has obviously been restored, as has it down here. The interior. There's one thing that worries me about the interior, I must say. If I look at the wear on the steering wheel, that indicates a higher mileage than might be indicated. That's quite a bit of wear. This fading is very normal. It's a very large, very thin rimmed steering wheel. And that's the differential lock button. That's in very good condition. I imagine that has been replaced. The carpet has been replaced. But here's the thing, you see here behind the steering wheel here, there is damage to the dashboard, and that worries me a lot. This is not in great shape, and the damage does concern me a bit. Here again, you can see that same piece of damage here. And the thing is with dashboards, they're difficult to repair. They're just difficult to repair. That could be one of the most difficult things to actually get right, but you know, I'm no expert when it comes to restoring cars, so I might find that actually, because it's not a piece of equipment in these cars that rusts, that it's actually quite easy to find. So I will actually find that out in the near future. That's all part of this pretty exciting story that I'm about to tell. So here, I'm sure that's been restored. That maybe hasn't, but the covering, very nice. Isn't that nice? These fold up and you get these horrible folds. And I remember even when I purchased my one, and it was, it was a 71 model, and I bought it and it was 10 years old. This is 45 years old. Even 10 years old, those bend up and look quite ugly quite soon. So the fact that this is complete and looking good is great. The dashboard looks good. That looks good. That looks reasonably good. This is where it rusts, down here. You get rust down here. There's none get rust around here. Masses of rust in the footwells. Footwells are a big problem, serious problem. Again, on this side, the door panels in really nice condition. They are original, and nothing else that alarms me at all about that view. Everything looks complete. Now the fan, there's the metal fan. The belt is obviously new. That's obviously new. Original, that's the water pump. That's definitely original, which that would need replacing. I will definitely replace things like water pumps. Another view from the left door, you can see the fading of the seat, and this is starting to come away. That's very typical. And in fact, my one, 1971 model, didn't have headrests. This has got headrests. The later versions, headrests came in from probably 75. At the back, this is remarkable, actually. That's the original scratching in the back. Absolutely normal. No rust or any problem around here. The fact that it still has the original grey rubber flooring. It's pretty amazing. These things tear up and get damaged very quickly. And I guess because the vehicle has a low mileage and has been stored well, that that's in good shape. The introduction video that I shot with Paul, this is absolutely original. That is original, that's original, and that of course is the crank handle that I was talking about, and the wooden handle that goes into that hole, that plus that plus that, and it's actually a very good jack. And that is the original carpet. So that is a piece of carpet that has not been changed. But if I look at the detail here, I'm seeing dirt and grime from 45 years, but I'm not seeing anything that can't be sorted, cleaned, painted with relative ease. Here's the thing that does cause me a little bit of concern. That is on 888. Now, on the side here, of the instrument binnacle, there is a little self-centering. Instead of, you know, you reset the odo, normally you press it, not with this, you actually twist, turn it, and then all of these numbers show the same number, and you go click, 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 until they're all at 7 or 8 or whatever, and then 9 and then 0. So here, either they haven't done it that extra 2 clicks, or they couldn't do that extra 2 clicks, or that doesn't work. If that doesn't work, it means that mileage is incorrect. By how much? Very difficult to say. People don't generally drive a lot with a car that has no speedo. It's not something that you leave alone for a long time. So the chances are that if that doesn't work, the mileage is probably not that much higher than that. That's my guess anyway. But the challenge is this: if that doesn't work, it is probably a small nylon gearbox that fits on that side. And that little gearbox would need to be replaced. And my guess is that to find that little gearbox will be quite tough. Let us have a look at the two videos I've been sent. And what can I see from the videos? If I look at the still images, I believe that is original. And the radiator original, brake booster original, expansion tank, exhaust pipes, carburetors, all looks original. That might be new. The plastic oil cover might be new. Let's hear it. So if I freeze the video, I can see here there's a bit of a mess with the alternator. That needs sorting out. Wires lying around, that's going to break eventually, that's no good. That can be sorted very easily. This is all original. Distributor cap looks original. I would be surprised if it is, but it's possible. These cables have been replaced, quite notorious with these motors. I remember, I think I replaced mine 2 or 3 times during the life, the high tension leads. One thing is that there is no tappet tick. These V8s often had tappet ticks. None at all. Very good sign. And no fuel leak around the carburetors. It actually looks very clean. The other video they sent me was this one. Yep. Is the startup to see if the exhaust pipe has any smoke.
Give it a rev.
So apart from the fact that there's no smoke, it's very good. But if I look here, that's original. And the rust behind here is actually a very good sign, because what happens with these vehicles when they rust badly, the rust builds from the bottom and actually crawls up, and you actually get rust on the inside, particularly around here, around the corner. And that is just a little bit of surface rust. And big question, of course, is, oh, but it's an aluminium vehicle. Range Rovers and Land Rovers are aluminium. No, they are not aluminium. We all wish they were aluminium. There are some aluminium body panels. That's not one of them. All right, the rear tailgate, upper and lower tailgates were both made of mild steel. Nice sound, though. Nice. Now I can see here, if you look closely here, there's a pipe that goes right through that. So the final small muffler that was put into this vehicle when it was made has been removed. They gave the Range Rover a very specific note, beautiful note, which this one doesn't have because it doesn't have that last little muffler silencer right at the end. But those, because they were right placed right at the end of the chain of exhaust pipe, they would corrode within a couple of hours of collecting the brand new vehicle. It was actually unbelievable how fast they would get holes in them, because of course the condensation in the exhaust would end up in that end piece, and it would never get particularly hot, so that end piece would always have water in it, and they would corrode incredibly quickly. So no surprises at all that it doesn't have that last muffler piece. But a very, very nice sound. These two videos were sent by the seller. I'm not surprised that he would like any buyer to know that it actually runs very smoothly. And if I think about those two clips, what I'm seeing, generally speaking, what I am seeing is I know that I took a risk. I did. Like the Land Cruiser in 2019, I took a risk, but it turned out very well indeed. I think this is going to too. Now, right now, I have arranged for my brother to go and collect the vehicle in Melbourne. He will collect it. He will take a camera with him. He will report back. He will be my eyes and ears on the ground in Melbourne because of COVID-19. I cannot get on an airplane right now, because my plan is to actually go there and set it up for driving it. Now, one of the logistical challenges is, because of COVID-19, to drive it back through Victoria, South Australia, and into Western Australia, crossing the state borders, means that if there are COVID restrictions on passing through those states or traveling through those states, it could mean a whole lot of things, including quarantine, including being stopped at the border and then having to go into quarantine before continuing, and there are issues which I will get to later in the story. My worry right now is, because the vehicle is not registered, I need to find somebody in Melbourne, trustworthy, who knows how to handle old cars and to get them roadworthy, to take my Range Rover and get it roadworthy for me. All right, I have Britpart, who is willing to supply plot parts. They're on board, they're very happy to help, but I can't go over there and do it. I just need the vehicle roadworthy, because imagine if I go over there and we try and get it roadworthy and there is a spare part that takes a month to get here. I want to avoid that, but only if a critical spare part is not available that'll happen during our big build, where we're actually preparing it for the trip, not preparing it for roadworthy. If such a thing happens, I have to say, oh well, luck ran out on that front. But I want to get it, if I can get it roadworthy before I get on a plane and go over there, I know with a fair degree of certainty that I will be able to get in it and drive it all the way home.
Thank you for watching. If you haven't already, subscribe and click the notifications bell so you don't miss our weekly videos.